Welcome back. This is season two. We got a special guest tonight. Hope you guys enjoy the episode tonight.
The Almighty, we forward in this generation.
For those of you that's tuning in, please go and follow us at our IG, LAS_podcast, and as well as on our website, LASpodcast.com.
These songs of freedom, cause all I ever have, redemption songs. Redemption songs.
The best.
What's up, my guys?
Take yourselves from mental slavery. None but the woods
out. Brandon.
I play your jam, I already know.
Get me in the mood.
Hey, I said I'm going to play this for you, man. I'm going to play this for you. Hey, man. I appreciate you taking the time to get on our show tonight, man. Really appreciate you taking the time, my brother. Yeah, man, how the family doing, man? How's everybody? How's the fam?
Man, no complaints. I got a football game right now, so everybody's there.
Okay. Okay, well, look, man, I already taken up your Friday. You should be out there watching this game, so yeah. I apologize, man. Tell a little man, I appreciate you, you know, you sacrificing to be on our show tonight, you know, not being at his game, man, but I appreciate it.
It's all good, my brother.
Man, so we're going to get right into it, man. For those of you that are joining right now, welcome to Life After Sports Podcast with your host, Kevin Johnson. This is season two, and we got a special guest in the house, Davone Bess, former NFL player, as well as Miami Dolphins wide receiver, man. And the theme for tonight, you know, we're playing the song. The theme for tonight is the redemption.
Absolutely, man.
So for those who understand your story, man, they'll understand this song.
Definitely.
But yeah, man, with that being said, man, I just want to say again, thank you. And, you know, just give people an opportunity to really understand you, not only as a football player, but your career and what you're doing now, post-career. The reason, and just to enlighten you, the reason I started this podcast last year is because I wanted to give a space to former athletes, current athletes, and industry professionals to talk about, you know, that transition from leaving from one phase of playing to the next phase of life. Is that with family, finding a new career, a new hobby? And I think a lot of times people just see the athlete and I identify, oh, he's just an athlete. And, you know, with LeBron's more than an athlete slogan, it's just so true. You know, it's more than you having a football helmet on and people playing. It's more than that, you know. So tonight we're going to just go and dive in head first, you know, into your life, man. And I appreciate you taking the time to be authentic.
Like I said, man, the pleasure's mine, man. I look forward to it, my brother.
All right, man. So jumping right in, man, tell me where did your journey start, man? Where did it begin, your childhood, you know?
Man, my journey started in East Oakland, California, man. You know, it was a lot going on. You know, I witnessed a lot, you know, as a kid. You know, it was just basically me and my mom and my younger brother, you know, for the most part. And I didn't really have a father growing up, you know. So football and, you know, my mentors and my teachers, you know, the people that I saw on a consistent basis, they became like my father figure, you know. And then, you know, my mom put me in sports at a young age. So that kind of kept me motivated, kept me focused, and kept me out of trouble as a youth. So I'm proud of Oakland. You know, it's definitely a place where you learn, you know, the grind, you know, and the struggle, and you know, just the different levels of, you know, just trying to make it out. You know what I'm saying? Something clicks. You know what I'm saying? Something when tough times hit. And you automatically want to just kind of get through it, you know, from a tough standpoint, you know. So I'm proud of where I'm from. I'm proud of the journey. You know, we'll get into more detail a little later. But, you know, Oakland's definitely been a big part of my you know, my balance and my upbringing and where I'm going now.
That's what's up, man. That's what's up. Now, I know you mentioned that you know, your mom put you in sports early. What do you remember that age group that you kind of fell in love with sports? And I know people may not know. They think they know about you that you were just football, but they don't know that you was a baller. They don't know that you could handle that rock.
Oh yeah. That was my first love, man. Hoop, you know, like I said, I had a podcast a couple of days ago with one of my old coaches, and you know, I told him, I'm like, man, I had hoop dreams, you know, when I was a youth, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, I played everything, man. Going back to elementary, kickball, you know what I'm saying? Flag football, basketball, volleyball, whatever it was, you know, as far as sports, you know, I wanted to be involved with it because not only from, you know, a competition standpoint, but it kind of just, it was my release, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. It was my release and my getaway, you know, from a lot of the shit that we seen, you know, growing up, you know what I'm saying? So I found comfort in it, you know?
Yeah, no, absolutely, absolutely. Now, throughout your childhood, my next question, throughout your childhood, what memories that you can remember that stands out in your mind that had helped shape and mold you into the person that you are today?
That's a great question. Right off bat, I would have to say, you know, watching my mother as a single parent mom get up every day and go to work. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So she couldn't really afford, you know, daycare and all of that, you know what I'm saying? And me and my brother spent a lot of time at home, you know what I'm saying? Our family, you know, our cousins and all of that.
Yeah.
Just seeing her grind, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Seeing her effort, seeing her getting up, having a routine every day because, mm-hmm. you know, she had to take care of us, you know what I'm saying? And that kind of instilled something deeper, you know, something deeper that resonated with me, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, you know, I love my mom. I'm forever grateful, you know, for her and, you know, the stuff that I witnessed as a youth that she went through. And it's definitely made an impact on my life. And I'm a better man today because of it.
Because of it. Yeah. And that was, I mean, she was your example. That was your leading example. And you just having the opportunity just to see what she was doing on a day in, a day out basis, you know, it made you just, you know, kind of just added fuel to your fire as a youngster, you know, wanting to emulate what you see in her and that grind process.
Hey, you, that's facts, man. That's facts because, you know, just to add on to what I just said, you know, she was 15 when she had me, bro. You know what
wow.
I'm saying?
Wow.
And that's really young, you know. My daughter's going to be 13 this year. And I could never imagine her having a kid 2 years. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
For her to, you know, have me at 15 and then have my brother 17 and we both turn out, you know, okay, you know what I'm saying? Job well done, moms, you know, and don't get me wrong, it's you know, that the same, you know, it takes a village to raise a kid, it's true because it wasn't just my mom, you know, it was my grandma, my aunties, you know, we had really good support growing up, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And to add on, like, with, you know, the coaches and the different relationships I built with the mentors and teachers, it was a collective group, collective.
Yeah, and people don't understand, it takes a village to really raise kids, to raise, especially in today's society, it's just not mom and dad, it's the whole village, your uncles, your aunts, the coaches, the mentors that are not associated with your family, but they're there like family.
Yep. Yep.
So, you know, in regards to, because I look back at the people who have influenced my life, and it was a lot. It was a lot of people that didn't even have to be hands-on with my family. And, you know, I look back today, and I'm like, I'm grateful for them for being in my life.
Yeah, major. That's major facts, bro.
Oh, man. So, with the interview that we're doing today, we're going to talk about pre-career, in-career, and we're going to go post-career. So my last question before we get into your in-career is let's talk about that life-changing situation that occurred right before you went to college.
You mean right after high school, right?
After high school, right after high school, before college.
You know, just to give you a little intro and, you know, a little segue into that. You know, I had the support of some really good people, you know what I'm saying? My senior year in high school, we had a good team that year, you know what I'm saying? Our coach kind of built it up. It was a senior team, you know? So I ended up playing quarterback that year because we didn't have a quarterback. You know, when I was a junior, the guy before, he was a senior, so he had graduated. So coach asked me to come play quarterback, and he said, "You do this, I'll get you a scholarship." So I was like, "Okay, I'm down." So we end up.
That's the grind. I ain't mean to cut you off. That's the grind. I'm gonna do whatever you need me to do, coach.
That's definitely the grind, and that's the attitude you gotta have, you know, especially, you know, when the coach is asking something of you, you know, you gotta kind of put your ego to the side, you know, and kind of make sacrifices to do what's best for the team, you know.
Absolutely.
And, you know, so we ended up winning the championship. We did really well. You know, some of my best friends that I still talk to this day, had a big impact on that season. You know, we had about 10 to 12 guys who went to Division I colleges that year, you know?
Yeah.
And, I was that guy. I was a late bloomer. I was that guy who didn't sign, you know, I was obviously talented on the field, but my past came back and haunted me once again, you know. I didn't do really good academically my freshman and sophomore year, and that came back and bit me in the you-know-what, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so, yeah.
With the help of, you know, my coach, Coach Beam, you know, we kind of mapped out a plan, you know, and that plan was to basically go back to my teachers, you know, from my freshman and sophomore year and see if I could do extra work or make up some credits for those classes, you know, and it worked out, you know, so I was doing that. I was doing this, this independent study with like a teacher that I had met through my coach. Her name is Miss Eskridge. I remember her to this day, but I did study classes with her. I did this BYU online class. I did BYU online classes with some really good friends of mine, Hopkins.
Yeah.
And, bro, so because you know when you're a senior, you're getting ready to graduate, right?
Yeah.
You're not taking that many classes. You know what I'm saying? You're probably done by 12 o'clock. You know what I'm saying? I probably was the only one in my senior class with the full load of classes.
Wow. Wow.
Trying to make up from where I messed up at so I can get this scholarship. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So to kind of move forward, I ended up getting the grades and I ended up doing really good, getting my grades together, getting the scholarship. And then July 9th, 2003, it was the day I got arrested. My life changed forever, bro. So to kind of segue into that, you know, it's, you know, in Oakland and in not even just Oakland, you know, all over the country, the world, in the inner city, it's shit to get into. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
It's a lot of guys that I know that I grew up with, you know, was this close to, you know, either making it or going the other way. You know what I'm saying? And I was one of those guys, you know, so I had got a phone call to go out and help, you know, be a part of some stuff that I shouldn't have been doing. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Long story short, we ended up getting pulled over. I was the driver. Soon as we got pulled over, they got us out, put us on the sidewalk, had us in handcuffs. So I'm on the sidewalk, and I see the police officers taking bags out of the trunk. They just taking bags out of the trunk. And I'm saying to myself, I'm like, damn, man, it's over. You feel me?
Yeah.
I'm like, it's over. You know, I didn't, not only did I work so hard to get this scholarship to go to college and make a difference for myself and my family, but I let a lot of people down, you know, that helped me get to that point. You know what I'm saying? And I think that's what weighed on me the most. You know what I'm saying? Like I was hurt the fact that I put myself in that situation, but you know, it's a lot of people behind the scenes who didn't get recognized or who didn't get credit for helping me get in that position to get a scholarship, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I kind of failed them, you know what I mean? So, long story short, man, I end up going to juvenile hall, you know? My mom tried to get me to get released to my actual county, which is Alameda County, you know what I'm saying? And, because where we got arrested at, it was a different county, you know?
Gotcha.
And nine times out of 10, if you get caught in somebody else's county, they'll transport you back to your county and then you'll get arraigned accordingly. You know what I'm saying?
Gotcha.
So the judge was basically trying to make an example out of me, you know? And she said, he said, nah, you're not going. You can't get out. You're not being released. And from that point on, you know, I kind of knew it was uphill battle. So that happened in July. I turned 18 in that following September. So when I turned 18, they sent me to county jail, you know? And that was probably one of the roughest experiences in my life, you know, not necessarily from a standpoint of, you know, trying to hold my own or you know, motherfuckers bothering me, none of that. You know, I knew people in there, you know, just from my family and, you know, and just knowing people, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The city's small. And so they sent me to county jail. And then when I turned 18, they sent me to county jail. The hardest part was trying to get adjusted to the fact that it was a 23-hour lockdown a day system in place. So that 1 hour that they let you out, they don't even tell you
ahead of time.
They just unlock your door, and then, you know, you either wake up and come out or shit, you sleep in your bed all day. If you sleep through it, you miss it. You know what I'm saying? And there were times I was in my cell all day. You know what I'm saying? So I had a lot of time to really think about, you know, my next steps, you know, if God were to bless me with a second chance, you know what I'm saying? So I was really preparing myself, you know, for this second chance, you know? So I ended up getting transferred back to juvenile hall for sentencing, and they sentenced me to a year. And I was thankful for that, you know, like when my public defender said they're going to give you a year at a boys' ranch, man, I'll take it. And because my maximum sentence as a juvenile was 15 years, 8 months. So when they gave me that year, I jumped on it. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, okay, I'll take that. So I ended up going to the Byron Boys Ranch, spent a year up there. The first guy I met there by the name of Amin Denny. He passed away some years ago. But I'm forever indebted to him, you know, because he was a big part of my transition, you know, from you know, being a star athlete, going to college to going to jail, and then, you know, kind of trying to figure myself out from there. You know, he was a big help and a big part of my transition from there to Hawaii as well. So it was a crazy experience. You know, I learned a lot from it, but most importantly, man, I grew from it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And look, the reason why I think people are tuning in, they're trying to figure out why the topic is called redemption, because obviously, man, you know, in life, we're in one phase, things happen, you know, it's one or two things you're going to do. It's either you're going to learn from it, you're going to grow, and you're going to continue to be a better person, or you're going to let that situation really dictate who you are as a person, and you don't grow from it and you stay in a bubble. And so talking about that and the life-changing event, you know, you wouldn't be the person who you are today if you didn't go through those different experiences, all right? So the next question, we're gonna jump into in career, you know, talking about your NFL journey. And then before your NFL journey, you went and played at the University of Hawaii. Talk about that. Talk about what you did there at the University of Hawaii, man.
Well, that was a special experience. You know, because I basically went from jail to paradise in like 2 months. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
So it was, you know, it happened fast. It was an eye-opening experience, you know, and I'm forever grateful to certain individuals who helped me with that transition. You know what I'm saying? My coach Beam, Keith Bonifa, Amin Denny, you know, Don Burgess, you know, this is a bunch of guys. And then not to mention, you know, Coach June Jones, you know, for giving me that opportunity, you know, like he didn't have to do that. You know what I'm saying? Like I was in jail. You know what I'm saying? He was watching highlight tapes from me when I was in jail. You know what I mean? And he didn't have to take that risk, but he did, you know? So I kind of felt like I not owed him, but I had to show him I was worth that risk. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So when I got to Hawaii, I didn't really know nobody, just a handful of people. And, you know, the first through people that I met, you know, was basically on the football team and became, we became best friends, you know, immediately and right away, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, one thing led to another, my focus was at an all-time high. I was determined. I was dedicated. I was really focused, you know what I'm saying, to make the most of the second chance, because I knew that if I got myself back in trouble again, I might not get the question again, you know?
Yeah. You might not get the opportunity. And you went ahead and you seized that opportunity when it came to you.
Absolutely.
So talking about that transition from you leaving University of Hawaii to going to the NFL draft, going undrafted, and actually going to the Miami Dolphins. Talk about that process and that experience, and you know, if that was something that's been always your dream to play in the NFL, what was that, you know, that process? And when I say that process, I'm talking about making the decision to leave University of Hawaii and enter your name into the NFL.
Yeah, man. So I didn't kind of go off what you said about, you know, thinking about the NFL and leaving early. I didn't start thinking about the NFL until after my freshman year in college. You know what I'm saying? And you got to think about it. Most cats, you know, that's in the NFL, most of them guys have been playing tackle football since they were six. So their dreams have always been to go to the NFL. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like I said earlier, I was a hooper. You know what I'm saying? So I didn't start thinking about the NFL till I got to college after my freshman year, you know. So I had, I worked my tail off, you know. I had great coaching. I had a great quarterback. I had great friends, great team. And, you know, I was set up for success, you know what I'm saying? We all bought into what Coach Jones was doing, you know, him and the coaching staff. Me and the quarterback both was trying to take advantage of a second chance. You know what I'm saying? He was on a second chance. I was on a second chance. And we both wanted to make the most of it, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, I thrived, you know? Everything you see, you know, in the highlights as far as, at University of Hawaii, is just a true testament of the work that I put in that nobody saw. You know what I'm saying? Because I grinded, you know. I had, you know, a bunch of teammates and a bunch of my boys I grinded with, but we grinded and we got after it, you know what I'm saying? And then the results paid off. So I had three really good productive years at Hawaii. I was healthy, you know, I didn't have too many injuries. You know, the only thing I can really risk coming back for my senior year was getting hurt, you know what I'm saying? So I had got a second round grade from the NFL advisory board, and that basically was the icing on the cake. Like, man, hey, it's time to go, you know? So, you know, the coaches in the NFL, you know, my draft status was pretty good. The only knock on me was, you know, how fast is he? They knew I can catch. They knew I can run routes. They knew I can separate. They knew I knew how to read coverages. They knew I can do all of that. You know, they knew how fast I can. That's what the NFL combine is all about. You know, how fast can you run? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I ended up declaring for the draft. Picked my agent, trained at a place called API in Arizona. From there, I went to the combine, didn't do too good at the combine. As far as the 40, you know, I ran a 4.6 at the combine. And, you know, I did well in all the other drills, but everybody wanted to see my speed. And I think it was a mixture of, like, you know, just pressure, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, you have to run this good time. If you run this good time, you're going to get drafted.
You're going to get drafted. If you run a bad time, you may not get drafted. That's a lot of pressure.
A lot of pressure. So from that standpoint, I ended up bouncing back. I did really well at my pro day. I ended up running a 4.48 at the pro day, but I pulled my hamstring doing that, you know what I'm saying? So I wasn't able to run routes for the scouts. And back then, we had every team at our pro day because of our quarterback. You know, they wanted to see him, and then they wanted to see who he was throwing to, you know? So I wasn't able to perform in front of them. So I think it was a mixture of me not running routes in person, me running the slow 40 time at the combine, and me going to jail as a youth was kind of, you know, the deciding factor why nobody took a risk on me.
Yeah. And so that, with all those three things that you mentioned here, and you landed with the Miami Dolphins, talk about that.
Well, that, you know, that was an easy decision for me to make, because that year, you know, the Dolphins didn't draft any receivers. You know what I'm saying? It was a new coaching staff, so I had an opportunity to come in and compete right away, you know. And then, you know, it was just, you know, I'm a warm weather boy, you know. To go from Hawaii to Miami, that's not a bad transition, you know?
Not at all.
So I was all in with it, you feel me?
Yeah.
And then, so I got the rookie camp and, you know, had my head down and had some really good teammates, pushing me, motivating me. We had a pretty good draft class that year, and, you know, it was a special group of guys, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I made the team, you know, that was a great feeling. You know, I worked my tail off, did really, really, really well, you know, worked hard, and, you know, the rest is history. You know, the rest kind of speaks for itself, you know?
Yeah. Now, talking about your career, my next question is talking about what was the most remarkable accomplishment that you've achieved in your career?
College or NFL?
NFL.
I mean, right now.
And mind you, 2008, not to interject like that, but 2008 was one heck of a season.
Yeah, it was. Actually, we went to the playoffs that year.
Yeah.
Remember the year before, it was like a 1-15 season.
Yeah, worst season ever.
Yeah. what's pretty cool, you know, and, you know, I've never been the one to really get caught up into stats and plaques and individual awards, you know what I'm saying? But I was on a podcast a couple days ago with my old coach, and he kind of brought it up, and when he said it, it kind of hit me, and I was like, damn, that is kind of big, you know what I'm saying? It kind of rewoke my game up, because I don't get too high, you know what I'm saying? I don't get too low. I'm just kind of, you know, in the middle. But, you know, just being able to be honored to have the second most catches in NFL history for an undrafted rookie free agent, you know, I think that's probably one of my biggest accomplishments in the NFL, you know, because it was hard sledding, you know, making that team, and then not only making that team, but proving to the coaches that I can play at a high level, you know. It was a process, you know, because they didn't trust me right away. I had to earn it. And, you know, I worked my tail off. You know, I had great guys in the locker room to push me and motivate me. And, you know, the results, you know, kind of they just came, you know. That's what happens when you put your mind to something. You work really hard. You visualize it. And you work every day towards that goal. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. No, absolutely.
And that's the best part about, manifestation. You know, you visualize it, you rep it in your mind. You know, you visually see it, and you work towards it every day. And then the next thing you know, bam, you did it. You know.
Yeah. Now, a lot of times, and I say this a lot of times, if I'm teaching coaching or I'm teaching students, talking about fall in love with the process and not fall in love with the destination. A lot of times, especially in this generation, you know, everybody want to be an instant success, right? So they fall in love with, you know, Jay-Z and all these other people. They don't understand that it was a journey for them to get to where they are today. And so a lot of kids, you know, they want to imitate the destination, but nobody want to imitate the journey, the process, the work, the grind, you know, the waking up at 3 a.m, waking up at 4 or 5 and having to make sure that their schedules on the same regimen every day so that they can be productive and see the productivity at the end of the year or the end of that season. So talking about your most remarkable accomplishment, let's talk about, and I don't like to say failures, but I like to say, what was the biggest challenge that you faced in your career?
From in the NFL?
Yes, in the NFL.
You know, I mean, I've experienced so much, bro. I would say the biggest disappointment to myself is probably not making time for myself.
Yeah. Wow.
And just to kind of elaborate on that, it was just like, you know, everything was just happening so fast for me, you know, from going to jail to going to Hawaii to going to the NFL. It just happened so fast. You know? Yeah. So I never really sat back and, you know, smelled the roses. You know what I'm saying? I never stopped to smell the roses. I never stopped to reflect on what I just went through.
Yeah.
Kind of just hopping these hurdles and just keep going, you know, not really sitting back and on it and digesting, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So I would say, you know, my biggest failure is probably not making enough time for myself, because if you're not right yourself, you can't be right for other people.
Man, that is so true. That is so true.
You got to be, you know, it's, and I, you know, I learned all this through my journey. You know, it's like it's a three-tier process. You know, that I call it. You know what I'm saying? It's like, yeah, you know, the mind and the body has to be connected. And then from that, it's the body, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So you got a strong mind, feed your body, you know, good stuff. You know, you exercise, you do these things, you know, to complement each other. So mind, body, and then action. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So action is, you know, you feel good mentally, you feel good physically because you're in shape, you're eating good. And then next thing you know, since you feel good, you treat people good.
Mm-hmm.
Your mood is better.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it's little things like that that I had to learn. It's little things like that I had to learn to really appreciate my journey. You know what I'm saying? It was tough. It was a lot of tears. It was a lot of hurt. It was a lot of pain. It was a lot of suffering. It was a lot of, you know, just lost moments, you know what I'm saying? Looking for guidance and just didn't know which way to go. But at the end of the day, you know, that's what life is all about. You know, bumping your head left to right, bumping your head, and then you bump your head that one time, bam, and then it's like, damn, it just hit you. Feel me?
Yeah. No, I definitely get that. For those who, you know, they know of you in regards to football, and this podcast gives people the opportunity to understand and know you outside of that. And that's the reason why I love, you know, having different guests on the show and like yourself taking the time to come on here. Let's talk about a little bit about mental health awareness, and how important is it to be cognizant of your own mental health? And I think a lot of times, a lot of players, people in general, they downplay it. I don't know if you follow the I Am Athlete podcast, with Brandon Marshall, Channing Crowder, which I had Channing on my show, Fred Taylor, and also Chad Ochocinco.
Yeah.
And they had this last episode.
Amazing job, man.
Say that again?
They're doing an amazing job.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And so they were just talking about mental checks, like mental checkups. You know, as brothers, we all sit around a table and we talk every day. And this is what they were saying. They're like, do we check in on our brothers? Do we check in on making sure that you are okay? Like, you know, how's your family doing? How's things going with you as a person individually? How's your business? And I just think that is so important. I think especially as Black men, we don't check in mentally with our family or friends and say, hey, you know, I just want to make sure you're good. And I think that's something that we should do as people, should do a little bit or a better job of doing that, because we're all going through different things at different phases of our lives.
Sure, for sure. And, you know, like, you know, that episode in particular that you're talking about was real, what Channing was saying, you know. You know, you got to be able to talk to your brother, you know, and check on him, you know. And I think the biggest issue right there, you know, you got to really step back a little bit, got to take a couple steps, really analyze the situation. And I learned this throughout my journey, you know, and what most Black men, and, you know, the upbringing, you know, being vulnerable, you know, vulnerability,
yeah,
is looked at as a sign of weakness. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And you got to think about it, you know, because, you know, I'm from Oakland, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, my coaches, my mentors, you know, my uncles, my cousins, you know, all my people, they like, man, you better get through that shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm talking about as a kid. You
feel as me? A kid, yeah.
Bothering you, it'd be like, get up, you know, yeah. Get that, you know, go do this, go do that. Don't be soft. Don't do that. And you got to sit back and think about it. That kind of messed you up psychologically. You know what I'm saying? Wow. And I just think that if we bring more awareness, you know, to our communities and not be so – what I'm trying to say? I just think if we bring more awareness to our communities that being vulnerable is actually a sign of strength versus a sign of weakness.
Weakness, absolutely.
We'll be headed in the right direction, because that was one of my issues when I was going through my mental health struggles, is that I was bottling everything up. You know, so everything that I'm going through, from jail to going to Hawaii to just everything in general, you know, that I experienced as a kid, I bottled all that shit up. You feel me?
Yeah.
And I didn't know how to ask for help. You know what I'm saying? So I would isolate myself. I didn't want to be around nobody. I would smoke hella weed. You know what I'm saying? and just be myself, you know, and that wasn't helping me. You feel me? Because, you know, and you know, ain't there's nothing wrong with me, you know?
No.
But if you're fucked up mentally,
yeah,
and you're not together mentally, psychologically, emotionally, it don't match, you know what I'm saying? They don't complement each other, you know what I'm saying?
So absolutely.
You gotta be balanced, you know what I'm saying? You gotta be well balanced mentally, spiritually, and emotionally.
Yeah.
You know, to kind of function, you know?
And deal with things that come along your way.
For sure.
Yeah. And I think it's important. That's why when I related to the show that they had just talking about mental checkups, I just think it's so important. You know, following your career, I've known you since when you started playing with the Dolphins through Paul Solei. I have to always give credit to him and Cole Meese. And I've always seen your work ethic. Your work ethic was, I mean, impeccable. You know, in regards to what you did on the field, but also people don't understand the things that you did within the South Florida community. And a lot of times I don't even know if you recognize, me and you ran path in different community events, like just running into each other. And I'm like, yep. D-Best, what's good? And you're like, Kev, I'm here. I'm at the radio station. I'm doing this. And people don't understand. Like, I seen a lot of the work that you did behind the scenes. And just understood that there was somebody like yourself who was just passionate about not only about yourself, it wasn't about you. You showed me something about just being selfless.
Yes,
and wanted to be able to help, even to help a community that you weren't even from South Florida, but you wanted to help the community that was there. So it was a couple events that we actually bumped into, the Eggapalooza event. You were signing autographs.
I remember that. That's making facts, bro.
Hey, I walked in and I'm like, yo, D-Best, you need something? You good? You know? And it was just good to see, you know, just see how open you were to just doing things within the community and not being asked. No PR person is pressuring you to do this. This is something that you was doing on your own. And so I got to be honest, man, as a fan of you, you know, I was disappointed when the whole situation with the Dolphins did, you know, wanted to trade you. That hit me in the chest, you know, because obviously I was a big fan of you.
Yeah, for sure.
And I don't know how that affected you mentally. You know, I don't even know what the situation was, because when I heard the trade, I said, this can't be true.
Yeah, man.
I said, how does man have a great season? Y'all tell me y'all want to trade him. I said,
it kind of went left, you know, real fast, you know. You know, just to sum up that whole situation, like first and foremost, you know, I created my foundation, you know, I got in the community and I did all of that, you know, just from my heart, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And not to get the recognition, you know what I'm
Absolutely.
Saying?
Absolutely.
So it's like when they traded me, that kind of set me back even more. So like pre-trade, I was kind of fucked up mentally. You know what I'm saying? I was dealing with a lot of stuff back home in Oakland.
Mm-hmm.
I was dealing with stuff with my foundation. I was dealing with stuff at home in my household. I don't know if you remember, but the year before that, you know, I had got hurt, you know what I'm saying? So I was dealing with that. It was just a lot of buildup.
Yeah.
And a lot of people pulling at me, you know what I'm saying? So I end up having a mental breakdown, you know what I'm saying? Mm. It basically, Baker acted me to the hospital, you feel me?
Wow.
And, you know, I just remember being at the hospital, you know, kind of just not understanding what was going on, you know? So next thing you know, I hear rumors that I'm potentially going to be getting traded, you know what I'm saying? And then, you know, when I heard that, that kind of sank me into a deeper depression, because it was like, you know, I don't have any animosity towards anybody in the organization.
Absolutely.
You know, but, you know, just from me, you know, growing up and kind of learning from my experiences and my mistakes and just the journey, I just feel like, you know, my play on the field, my work in the community kind of spoke for itself, you know. So for you to get rid of me because I had mental health issues, that kind of didn't sit right with me for a while. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And that wouldn't sit right with anybody, to be honest with you.
And I'm not even gonna say they got rid of me because I had mental health issues. You know, I'm just kind of looking at the big picture, you know, but you know, if I was on the other end, if I was on the other end, I kind of would approach it as, okay, this is one of our guys. I'm going to try to help him get to the root of the issues that he's going through. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Instead of shipping him away and having him kind of figure out it on his own, you know. But at the same time, you know, I'm grateful for that because I grew from it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. But
imagine if they didn't trade me and I stayed or whatever, I wouldn't have got the knowledge and the experience that I got now. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And everything in life happens for a reason. You either, like I said earlier, either you learn from it or you let that situation dictate your movement and you feel captive to that situation. You know, while playing, my next question to you, while playing professionally, you know, have you ever thought about life after sports? And I know that when I met you, you were doing so many things outside of football.
Yeah.
So people that don't know, like, you would have thought that you were born in South Florida just based on the things that you were doing.
Right.
And so, I know me and you talk, you know, about it, you know, things that went wrong with your, you know, with your foundation, had nothing to do with you, but just the things that went on. I know that it weighs heavy on you, especially when you're a loving person and you're trying to give, and then you're giving so much and people are taking, especially at the moment in your life where you need people to be like, you know, are you okay? Let me do that mental health check.
Absolutely, bro. Bro, you speaking major facts right now, bro, and that's exactly what I experienced right there, you know?
Yeah.
I'm a good person, you know, I got a good heart, you know, and I get that, you know, from my mom and my family, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, you cross me, you'll see another side, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you know, I just kind of overextended myself, you know what I'm saying? I overextended myself to everybody, you know, I was trying to make everybody happy. But, that goes back to that balance I talk about. You got to be right with yourself before you can help other people, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, yeah, man, you know, I just really learned from that experience and you know, I've really dove deep into, you know, taking care of myself first, you know?
Yeah. And that's good. That is good. I mean, it's able to help you move forward.
Yeah. It's power, you know? It's power in that, bro, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. So talking about, we talked about post-career, I mean, in-career, pre-career, in-career. Now we're going to go dive into your post-career, you know, and I think you've wrapped this up. You've said it a little bit, you know, just talking about describing what you've learned about yourself throughout this journey. And, you know, if you had to wrap that up in one sentence, what would that be? You know, describing what you've learned.
And like overall, I just came to the conclusion that, you know, cause you know, I like to, I like to listen now. You know what I'm saying? I've always been a good listener, but I'm an even better listener now. You know what I'm saying? I listen to people talk. I listen to a lot of podcasts. I listen to, you know, I listen to my kids more. You know what I'm saying? Like, instead of jumping to conclusion, like, I know everything. I listen now. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's growth. You know what I mean? That's absolutely growth, you know? So just throughout all of that, I would say the biggest thing for me is understanding that failure is an opportunity to do it all over again, but in a more intellectual standpoint, from an intellectual standpoint, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you go through your experience and you bump your head, boom, you're like, okay, that shit didn't work. You know what I'm saying? you're like, that didn't work. So now it's like, okay, I'm going through this journey, and then I see this same situation again. I'm not doing that shit I did last time.
I'm not.
You feel me? I'm not doing that. So you learn from it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's taking that new opportunity and learning from what you did wrong the last time and readjusting your route. You know?
I like that point. Readjusting your route. People don't know, man. You a great route runner, to be honest with you.
I took pride in that, man. You know?
When I look at the game now, right, and of course it's changed from when you were playing to what it is now. It's changed every year. There was one player that was playing for the Dolphins that reminded me of you in regards to his work ethic, his hands, the way he can catch the ball and just run and just take off.
Jarvis Landry.
How do you know, man? How do you know?
I know, man. I know players. I know football. I know the game, bro. And I can, you know, I like Jarvis a lot, man, because – you know, not only everything you just mentioned as far as his work ethic, catching the ball, wanting the bullseye to move the chains, I saw a lot of me in him, you know? And when I and to be completely honest with you, bro, you know, when he got on the scene in Miami, I was really in a deep, dark place then, you know, so I didn't really watch football, you know. I was bitter towards football. I was bitter towards you know, me sitting on the couch trying to figure out why the fuck I'm on the couch not doing nothing. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Why did this happen to me? How did I go through all that shit from getting out of jail? You know, even the shit before the jail, you know, with my upbringing and shit I seen then. How did I go through all these ebbs and flows, get to the mountaintop and just fucking fall on my face?
Yeah.
You feel me? I had a really, really, really hard time trying to figure that shit out, bro. You know what I'm saying? And it's a process, you know? Yeah. You know, one day leads to the next day. The next day leads to 3 days. 3 days leads to 4 days. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's the approach you got to take as far as healing from a mental standpoint. You have that's healing. You know what I'm saying? And so, like, you know, not to get off topic, but, you know, I saw a lot of myself in Jarvis, man, and he made me really proud. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I love the work ethic. I love what the relationship him and Tannehill build together. You know what I'm saying? And don't get me wrong. I was so dark. I was so dark in those moments, and I'm so vulnerable now. And I can be honest with y'all, and I'm say I was a little bitter. I wasn't jealous, but yeah. I was a little bitter. Like, man, those supposed to be my balls that he catches.
Yeah, yeah.
You feel me? Yeah. And that regulated in my mind because I was fucked up mentally. You feel me?
Yeah.
And I learned from that, bro. And it's, you know, it's a lot of strength and it's a lot of strength and a lot of a lot of courage, you know, in your trials. You feel me? And like the shit, the ebbs and flows, and the shit that you go through.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you, it's fucking power in that, bro. And yeah, people don't see that. You know, you can easily go in the tank, or you can go the other way and learn from it and grow and evolve.
And grow.
You know?
Yeah.
A lot of people don't see that evolving stage.
They don't see it. Let me tell you why they don't see it, D-Bess. You can't see the evolving stage when you've been in a situation where you're always capitalizing on your winning, right? It's a difference, right? If you're capitalizing and you're winning, right? And you've never faced adversity, right? I'm listening to your story. You have faced adversity every single step of the way, and it has built character. It has built different things with the person that you are and that you know today. So when I look back, you know, not look back, but when I'm looking based on hearing what you're saying and hearing those moments of, you know, at that time, I'm seeing somebody else catching the ball and I'm on the couch and I'm thinking to myself, man, that should be me. You know, a lot of players don't get the opportunity to really sit back, right? To sit back and really acknowledge, you know, man, this, I was here at this phase when I was playing. Now I'm in a different phase now. And I got to either, if I'm going to sit here on the couch, I'm going to sit here and continue to still and say, what if I could have did that. Or am I going to get up today and move on to the next direction for tomorrow? So talking about the new direction for tomorrow, you know, what new projects or opportunities that are coming down the pipeline? I know you're working on something, man. I already know you are. And I didn't ask you before. I said, I'm going to wait till the show, put you on the spot. But I know you're working on something, man.
You did put me on the spot, bro. You know, I got a few things I've kind of been working on, you know, just to backtrack a little bit before I answer that question. Bro, it took me a good 5 or 6 years to really get back.
Yeah.
That's a long time, dude. 5 or 6 years.
Yes.
Bro.
Yeah.
You understand? And so through all that, you know, like I said, I found strength, I found vision, I found clarity, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And right now, you know, my main focus, you know, because I know as time goes on, you know, opportunity in itself, you know, but right now my main focus is me, my family, you know, my kids, my wife, you know, my mom, brother, aunties, uncles, you know, just the people, the tight people that matter.
The tight people that's in your circle that matter.
The tight people that matter right now. That's my main focus. But, you know, not only that, you know, my passion was my foundation, bro. You know what I'm saying? Like, I really took pride in waking up, going to, you know, all these high schools in Fort Lauderdale and Dade County. I took pride getting up on my day off every Tuesday during the season to go talk to these kids and share my story. You know what I'm saying? Because it resonated with them, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. They found a connection, and that when I saw that connection, I felt the positive energy, you know what I'm saying? And that motivated me to a new level. So right now I'm in the process of revamping my foundation, basically with the same message, just with a little different twist, you know. So before, my foundation was basically geared towards, you know, mentorship,
mm-hmm.
and developing programs for kids, you know, to basically hear my story, take these concepts from my story, tell me what you know about them, tell me what you learned about them, put them in an essay, I'll read them, whoever got the best essay, bam, you get a certain amount of money, certain amount of dollars towards a scholarship, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But now, my focus is basically, you know, the same thing, but I wanna go into underprivileged and underserved communities and really dig deep and help people who struggle from a mental health standpoint, who's impacted by, you know, the trauma that you create going through mental health, you know what I'm saying? So I kind of want to, you know, take this mental health stuff serious, you know, and kind of affect, you know, and kind of make an impact on people who's really out there struggling and don't have the resources to deal with their problems to move forward, you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
And a big part of my decision to do that is my boy Brandon Marshall, you know. You know, he took the pledge and basically was like, you know, I'm going to go full-fledged with this mental health thing to kind of help and impact. And that was very motivating to me, you know what I'm saying? So I'm in that same space right now where I feel like I can make an impact with my story, with my journey.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's my thing right now, you know?
Yeah.
Not only that, you know, I got things going, you know, from a business standpoint as far as, developing my own training program, you know, trying to basically give kids the opportunity to get better on the field and in life, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm coach slash mentor in a sports environment space, you know what I'm saying? So my foundation, my business, the best route of capital will basically kind of feed off each other, you know?
Okay. Well, I'm gonna go ahead and extend my arms. Like I told you in 2008, 2009, I said, I don't know if you remember when I said, hey, man, if you got anything going on, you let me know what I can do to support.
I definitely will, bro.
I said that to you before. I'm going to say it to you again. And I know that your story, not only on here on this podcast show that we have going on tonight, but your story resonates with a lot of people, you know. For those who know you, those who don't know you, your story alone could definitely help people who are suffering or who are actually going through a situation where they're looking for help. And so if you need any help getting back here to South Florida, because we need you to get back here when you get a chance, you know, once all this COVID stuff is done.
Sure.
But
I'm gonna pop up.
Say that again.
I'm gonna pop up like Houdini, bro.
Pop up, man. And there's definitely some people that I want to connect you with. Dr. Thelma Tenney, she's also big in the space of mental health awareness, and she has a foundation that does a lot of work with underprivileged kids in the certain communities here as well. So I want to make sure I connect you with her.
I said that's the space I'm in right now. You know?
Okay. So I'll make sure that I make that connect. I just think if you're planning on doing things, if you come back here to do some things, whatever I can do to help, just know you got a brother here in South Florida, my brother.
Salute, bro. I appreciate it.
Nah, absolutely. So as we almost come to end, man, my next question to you, what advice, you know, would you give to a professional athlete based on your journey? You know, if you had any advice to give based on your journey, your experience, your story, you know, the good, the bad, the ugly, you know, as a professional athlete, because you know the things that they go through as a professional athlete, you know, what advice would you give?
I mean, that's a great question, man. I can go different avenues with, you know, but I just want to say, you know, the main thing that sticks out right away is, first off, you know, just self-care, self-love, you know what I'm saying? You have to love yourself. You have to appreciate yourself. You have to find value, and you have to really take the steps, the proper steps as far as taking care of your mental health, because shit gets overwhelming, especially being a professional athlete. You got a million things to do, community shit. You got family shit. You got appearances.
Yeah, you're right.
It's just a lot of stuff on your plate, you know? So First thing I would say, take care of yourself. Second thing I would say is probably, you know, find a good team to surround you. And that's not necessarily entourage I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about agents. I'm talking about financial advisors. Marketing managers, you know, you gotta surround yourself by a team that has your best interests. You feel me? And not thinking the other way, like, okay, I can capitalize off this player.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? You really gotta think about, you gotta check them and make sure that they are there to support you first and foremost. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And I didn't really do that 100%. I kind of gave anybody an opportunity, you know, and eventually I learned that you can't really do that with everybody, you know?
Yeah, man,
it's a journey. I learned from it and I'm better because of it, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Learn the power of listening. Learn the power of listening, man. You know, everybody got it figured out. Everybody think they got it figured out. You know what I'm saying? So you're going to have a bunch of people in your ear. You should do this. You should do that. You should do that. You need to do, you know, listen to your gut feeling. You know, You know, I'm a big Bob Marley fan, and I appreciate you playing that redemption song to enter us into the conversation. But, you know, just to get on one of his deep quotes that sticks with me every day, you know, he was like, he's basically saying, you know, in every situation, you know, through the walks of life, you know, that you go through,
yeah,
there's a little voice inside of you that tells you, okay, that's a good thing to do, or that's a bad thing to do.
Yeah.
He said the difference is that if you're willing to accept that, because that's God, you know what I'm saying? That's God talking to you.
Mm-hmm.
Are you willing to accept the phone call from God, or are you going to hit decline and ignore him and then find out the consequences later? So, you know, we all put in situations where we got to make a decision. You know what I'm saying? Yeah,
absolutely.
And if you hear good, if you listen good, you will do the right thing.
Yeah. Boy, that's deep right there. You over here dropping gems. So you maybe not want to end this show, man. What's up? What's good? We might have to have a deep best part two.
Man, shit, bro. We'll be here all night talking, bro. Give you all my secrets though, man, because I eventually want to get this book going too. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, man, look. I'm, and when you finish with that book, let me know so I can go ahead and purchase my copy. You know, talk about books, man. I just finished my dissertation for my doctorate degree, and I think I told you that the other day. And the topic of my book is the perception of professional athletes' social activism on their career, longevity, financial, social, and longevity.
All right, man, that's big, man.
So it'll be in Google soon, so you could just Google it on ProQuest and check it out. But
I definitely got to check that out, bro.
Absolutely, man. I got some people that you know that I interviewed in that book. So please make sure you check it out, man. But
gotcha.
You know, I appreciate you just taking the time to come on our show tonight, man, and share your story, share your gems. I mean, hopefully, and I know it. That your story is going to minister to somebody.
I really hope so, bro. I don't mean to cut you off. I'm sorry for cutting you off. But that's my inspiration, man, and that's what keep me going. You know, because I know, you know, when I was going through my phase, bro. You know, I tried to reach out to a lot of people, and you know, I got rejected. You know. I had to figure this out on my own, you know. So I kind of did some deep thinking, some deep soul searching, and it just hit me that you know, bro, get out of this funk, bro. Like you ain't the only one going through this shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And that kind of hit me, bro. So if somebody can, you know, benefit or learn from this, or get inspired or motivated by it. You know, that's job well done, and that's all I want. You feel me?
Yeah, absolutely, man. I'm excited to see that book that you're gonna be writing soon, because boy, I tell you, if you think that your story just by you talking about it is one thing, but you put it in a book is a whole nother thing.
You know what's crazy is because like I've been, you know, when I was going through my journey, I was trying to like, damn, I need to write this book. I need to get my story out. But, you know, God set me down and said, bro, you're not done yet. Why the fuck are you writing a book? You know, I would beat myself up, bro. Like, I got to get this book done. I did hella writing. I got notebooks in my drawer right here in my desk. Full of writing and just writing, you know, trying to force it, you know. And I just thought to myself, man, like, I'm just getting started, bruh.
And just getting started. Look, man, I like to end the show like this. We normally ask our guests, you know, so that we can continue to keep this podcast flowing with different people that we're interviewing. If you could list three people that you would like to nominate to tell or share their stories about their journey as being a professional athlete or an industry professional, either or. If there's three names that you can mention on here, and then I'll hold you accountable so that I can get in contact with them.
Wow.
But we're just trying to continue to keep the narrative going where people could come on here and share their story, man, share their life experiences so that they could be able to continue to help other people, man. Well, and your story tonight helped, it definitely helped me. It helped some other people, and it's going to continue to do that.
Well, you know, just, you know, just you know, off the top of my head right away, you know, I listen to a lot of people, man. Like, it's just really hard. Shit, it's just really hard for me to just pick somebody, you know, but I don't know. There's three people that I do have in mind that played a huge impact on my, you know, my what you call it? Not recovery, but my, just me bouncing back, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And inspired me to get my ass back up and inspired me to get back in the gym, inspired me to do whatever I want to do from my heart. You feel me?
Yeah.
And two of them are dead, unfortunately.
Wow.
One of them is alive, and I'll tell you who that person is. He's actually from South Florida.
Okay.
He's from Broward, which is really crazy that, you know, I was right there next to him in that space, and we never crossed paths. But that person is Ace Hood. You know?
Oh, wow.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know, Ace Hood don't really get the credit he deserves. But I had a really deep connection with him through his fucking music, bro, and just listening to the shit he was saying.
Mm.
You know? And that's the great thing about people, you know? That's the great thing about people is that, you know, people are fucking great, bro. We are great. We are great, and we're able to do some powerful stuff. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I just want to say, you know, with Ace Hood's situation and all the shit that he went through, you know, I don't really know in detail, you know, the shit he went through, but besides the shit in his music, but the biggest thing that stood out to me in my journey and his journey is really, you know, the failures as far as, you know, being rejected and then having to find yourself on not only a mental standpoint, but spiritual standpoint.
Yeah.
And understanding that you are great.
Mm-hmm.
There's greatness inside of you. You know what I'm saying? And you can really impact the culture. You can impact the community. You can impact the people by just being 100% genuine, authentic, transparent, you know what I'm saying? And telling your stories and being proud of your struggles, you know? So yeah. I salute Ace Hill for that, man. He helped me find the light, you know what I'm saying?
Wow, that's big, man, that's big. I don't know him personally. I know his wife that he married recently, and I know her, Sheila Marie. But I definitely listen to his music, man. But definitely, I met him before, but I have a good relationship with his wife. But man, next time that you come down here, man, I'm going to figure out how we can make this happen, man. You can connect with him, man. Absolutely, because I think y'all journey, your stories are similar, you know? Sure. Different industries, but still similar.
For sure.
So, again, man, I just want to say thank you for taking the time to come on this show, man. Look, I even feel sorry that you missed Little Man's game tonight. You know,
oh, man, you know, crazy too, because my wife just sent me, she just sent me a video. She said he had a pick six. I'm gonna post it later though. Don't even care.
The best, man. I look, man. I appreciate you, man. Paul's wife just joined. She joined. She's in here somewhere. So just say hey to her, man.
What's up, Todd? Much love, man. Much love, Paul, man. Love y'all. Miss y'all. Back soon, man.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, man. But look, man, I just want to say thank you again, man. I love you, bro. I love you. Love your wife, your kids. And we definitely got to connect in person soon, man. And thank you for coming on the show tonight, man. And this is season two of Life After Sports podcast with your host, Kevin Johnson. We're here with Davone Bess. And man, it was an awesome night, man. I appreciate you, my brother.
Hey, go get you some of that Waikato Hawaiian volcanic water too, man.
Okay, I'm going to check it out.
It's some good stuff, bro.
Yeah. Well, look, I'm definitely going to do that. My girl going to make sure that we go ahead and get that done as well, because she's listening to the podcast. So.
Okay.
All right, man. I love you, my brother.
I love you too, man. Many blessings, bro.
All right, man. You take care, man. Have a good night, man. I love you, man.
For sure.
Peace.